Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafil anbiya wal mursaleen. Nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsan ila yawmid din. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we welcome you to this tonight's lecture that we have our guest tonight, Brother Jan Fontaine from Manchester, and he will be sharing with us his story. How did he accepted Islam, his journey towards this religion of Islam, the religion of peace. And if you have some questions later, you can ask him, inshallah. And after his talk, I will be sharing some steps in order to achieve inner peace. And first of all, we'd like to thank Zaid bin Muhammad family gathering for giving us the opportunity to share this Islamic knowledge to you. And the Islamic Affairs and Charitable Activities Department of Dubai. And also, I would like to inform you that this lecture is available live on YouTube. Even after the lecture, you can search in YouTube, Ayakad, live stream. So now I will be giving the microphone to Brother Jan Fontaine to share us his story about his acceptance of Islam. Jazakumul khair.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah. Assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum
assalam. Wa alaikum everyone. MashaAllah. I'd just like to thank again, I'd like to show my thanks to Zaid bin Muhammad Family Gathering for hosting this event and giving me the opportunity to actually come here and see you all. And of course, we thank the Islamic Affairs Department as well for allowing this to happen. Before we go into the topic, I'd just like to thank you all for coming and joining us here today. I know it might start raining, but inshallah, we'll carry on. Now, my name is John Fontaine, and I was born and raised as a Christian. I actually come from Manchester in the United Kingdom, and I was born and raised in the city of Manchester. And from a very young age, I knew that Christianity for me was not the correct religion. I remember when I was 7 years old, I was asked to write a song about God in church. And the title of my song and the chorus to my song was Jesus and God. Jesus and God. And I always remember the pastor at the church. He took my piece of paper and he scribbled out the song and he said, no, Jesus is God. And subhanAllah, from a very young age of being, you know, from like the age of 7 years old, this did not fit with my fitrah. You know, my inner belief of the Creator was something entirely different. How could a man be God? How could something that is a part of the creation be a part of the Creator? So from a very young age, I knew that Christianity was not for me. It simply wasn't for me. It's not what I believed. And this is what we call in Islam the fitrah. And now I'm a Muslim. I know that every human being is born in the pure state of the fitrah. The fitrah is being able to acknowledge the truth, being able to acknowledge the Creator. Every human being is born with the correct belief in the Creator. Now, through my teenage years, I became distracted with God. I still believed in the Creator, but the Creator became a part of the back of my mind. I began to believe that religion is man-made, but I still had this small belief in a Creator deep inside me. But I put the subject of religion and the subject of a Creator to the back of my mind, and I came distracted with the worldly life. From the age of 14, I was working in like a bar, in a club, selling alcohol. I was around alcohol and music. And from a very young age, I became a jazz singer. I started to sing and perform in clubs and jazz clubs and football stadiums and weddings, all sorts of events, not just in England, but all over the world. I was singing on cruise ships, football stadiums, you name it. And I was making a good living from singing. I was making a lot of money, but I wasn't happy. This is one of the things, subhanAllah, we're speaking about the journey of inner peace. And subhanAllah, Allah tells us that only in the remembrance of Allah do your hearts truly find rest. And this is something. This is one of the ayah that really helped me understand, because I was chasing the dunya and I was being given the dunya. I received the dunya, but I wasn't happy. And to the extent that in my jazz career, I got to a very high level. I was singing with the very famous people, singing with very famous jazz musicians in very famous jazz clubs. And I got to the end of the life. I thought, I'm not happy. Is this all there is? You know, my whole dream had come true, and it was no longer my dream. SubhanAllah. So at the age of 18, in Manchester, there was many Africans started to move to Manchester. Many refugees, many workers. And I came into contact with some brothers from West Africa, mainly like Senegal, Sierra Leone. And I started to do business with them. I was only 18 years old, but alhamdulillah, I'd managed to save a lot of money. So I started to do business. I started to study diamonds. I started to do business with cars and different electrical equipment in Africa. And this is what started my journey to Africa. So I sent some cars to Sierra Leone, and it came to a point where I had to go to Africa. So on my journey to Africa, I went to a place called Senegal. It's in West Africa, and it's a majority Muslim country. And the people are very friendly, very nice. But at this time, I was very scared of Muslims. I had a lot of misconceptions about Islam. I thought all Muslims were terrorists. You know, subhanAllah. Complete opposite. And I found myself staying in a hotel, but I had no money, because all my money was tied up in business in Sierra Leone. So I had to go to the hotel manager. And I spoke to him. I said, look, I don't have any money to stay in your hotel. You know, I've stayed in this hotel for a few days, and I don't have any money to pay for it. He said, no problem. You can come to my house. But there was a problem. He was a Muslim, and I was scared of Muslims. But I had no option. I had no money. And at this time, I couldn't phone home. I couldn't phone my parents, because my parents didn't know I was in Africa. I told them that I was in London, because if I told them I'm going to Africa, they wouldn't let me go. I was only 18 years old, you know, subhanAllah. So I was stuck. I had to go to his house, subhanAllah. Yeah, there's no other option. I had to go. So I went to his house, and one of the first experiences I had was hearing the adhan. SubhanAllah. It's an amazing experience. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. SubhanAllah, when you hear the adhan for the first time, I know many of you in the audience are Muslim, and you won't remember the first time you heard the adhan. But every single one of you, the Muslims, when you was born, your father, subhanAllah, or one of your family members would have recited the adhan and the akama in your ear. From the very moment you're born, you know, subhanAllah, the adhan will be recited. Why? You don't know Arabic when you're born, but your fitrah understands the call to the salah. Come to salah, come to success. You know, success, the peace, the salah, the success is in the salah and in the worship of Allah. SubhanAllah. And the fitrah understands this call. And subhanAllah, when I first heard the adhan, it was like something just entered my heart. I wanted to know more about it. And if you go onto YouTube, subhanAllah, you'll see many Westerners when they travel to Muslim countries like the UAE, like Turkey, and many other countries. when they hear the Adhan for the first time, there's so many videos on YouTube of people crying, and they don't know why, they can't explain it. And this is what happened to me. It was truly a spiritual experience. But this didn't make me convert to Islam. This made me look into Islam. I wanted to know more. I wanted to know more about Islam. During my time in staying in this brother's house, his grandmother passed away. And I remember he was sat on the bed and he was crying. So I sat next to him. I put my arm around him to comfort him. And I just said something like, "Don't worry, she'll go to a better place." You know, I was trying to comfort him. And he said, "I'm not crying because she's passed away." He said, "Alhamdulillah, she's a Muslim. She's going to Jannah." He said, "I'm crying because she was a very old lady. She was 102 years old." He said, "And I wanted you to meet her because I wanted her to make dua that you would be a Muslim." He said, "Because she's an old lady, Allah will accept her dua, inshallah." He said, "But, you know, subhanAllah, you didn't get the opportunity to meet her." And this really had an effect on me because I could see that he was not upset at all about her death. You know, because he was so certain that she was a Muslim and she's going to a better place. And subhanAllah, during this time living with his brother and his family, he was observing the salah. I was witnessing him pray and seeing him doing sujood. And all of this had an effect on me. The fitrah recognized all these things. No one needed to explain Islam to me. No one needed to explain sujood or the adhan. It made sense. And subhanAllah, but he still didn't make me convert. You know, for many years, I was struggling. I was learning Islam with the intention to refute it. Mm-hmm. You know, and funny enough, I left Christianity, but I was using Christianity. I was actually using Christianity to defend myself, you know, to try to poke holes in the Quran and the Hadith. But every time, my misconceptions were always answered, time after time. My answers, you know, my questions were always answered. Islam seemed to have the answer. And this is one of the miracles of Islam. It has answers to everything, subhanAllah. We're not expected to believe blindly. You know, like there's a lot of beliefs out there where they're told not to question their belief. But Islam is totally different. Allah tells us to question. We're supposed to know why we are Muslim. So after Senegal, I moved on to Sierra Leone. Now, I've just come back from Sierra Leone. I'll speak more about that in a moment if I get time. But I went on to Sierra Leone. Now, Sierra Leone was slightly different. It's not a majority Muslim country. And, you know, the poverty is so much, subhanAllah. And I came into contact with people who claimed to be Muslim, but they were doing bad things. They were involved in magic and shirk and all sorts of evil things. And this became very apparent to me, you know, many years ago. But I actually thought that this was a part of Islam. When people were dealing with the jinn and dealing with sihr and magic, I actually thought this was a part of Islam. I didn't know that this is against Islam, that this is forbidden in Islam. So when I returned to the UK, I have a very good friend who's from Libya, and I started to question him. In England, we started to grill him about Islam, you know, questioning him, giving him a good grilling, you know, wanting to know the answers. And I told him about all these practices in Africa. And he said, "No, this is haram. This is shirk. This takes you outside the fold of Islam." So I started to do more and more research. He gave me the correct sources to go to. He gave me some YouTube channels with you know, good sources of information. And slowly but surely, I started to believe more and more about Islam. As I said, my belief in Allah has always been there. But the more I research and learn about Islam, the more my belief grows in Islam itself, in the actual religion and the deen of Islam. SubhanAllah, after many years of questioning and studying and looking into Islam, I started to fast Ramadan. Ramadan came, okay. And I started to fast. I don't know why, But I wanted to fast. You know, I knew it was the month of Ramadan. And I fasted. And then I even started to pray. Not the same way as Muslims, but I started to do sujood. Just sujood. Sujood, putting my head on the floor, just speaking to Allah. And I had a friend in Egypt. And it was a February time. About 8 years ago, I went to Egypt, and I went with my friend to the mosque, to the masjid. And this was the first masjid I ever went to. And he bought me a copy of the Quran. I was so happy. This was the best gift, subhanAllah, anyone could have given me. And he took me to the masjid, and he started to pray. And I asked him, please show me how to pray. You know, I really want to know how to do the salah. And he said, no. He said, I can't show you how to pray because you're not a Muslim. I said, look, I believe in Allah. I believe in His Messenger. I fasted Ramadan. He said, no, you have to say the Shahada. And I said, what is the Shahada? And he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. You know, to testify that there's nothing worthy of worship except Allah and that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is His Messenger. And so I said the Shahada. And this was the official, you know, the official time that I actually stepped into the fold of Islam. And from there, I went back to England, started to learn the Salah properly, learn more about Islam. And this is a very brief journey on the key points that really brought me to Islam. SubhanAllah.
So, brother, what was the reaction of your family when they learned that you accepted Islam?
SubhanAllah. It was, you know, my family were the same as me. They were scared about Muslims. You know, all they knew about Islam was what they learned in the media. You know, all these things that the media tried to portray Islam as. And so they were very scared. Understandably, they were scared. You know, they thought I'd become an extreme person. They thought I'd become a bad person. And they were very worried. They had a lot of concerns. And they was not happy at all,
but
subhanAllah.
They reached to the point that they drove you out of your homes.
It came to a point where I left my family home because I left by my own because it was difficult, you know, because in the household there was a lot of pork, alcohol, you know, I couldn't pray properly in the house, you know, Fajr, these type of things, you know, because there's no mosques in near the area, you know, you can't, you know, you wake the whole house up, you know,
subhanAllah. Inner peace, if there is no peace in your environment.
Yes, subhanAllah, this
you
is...
To find ways to...
Yeah, you have to leave for the sake of Allah, you know. It was very difficult. At the time, I didn't have much money because I'd left, you know, doing business and other things. But my family were very worried. My sister was worried as well, understandably. But now, alhamdulillah, they're okay. You know, my extended family, you know, also they were worried, you know. I don't... funerals, or I try to avoid these events.
So
you know, I don't
go
to these events.
Family members accepted Islam?
No, I have over 60 family members, and I found out that one of my cousins, he's actually looking into Islam. I had a message from a brother in England, and he messaged me on Facebook, and he asked me, was such a body my cousin. I don't want to say which cousin it is because I know if his father finds out, subhanAllah, he's a big fitness, subhanAllah. Because this particular uncle is, he was like the one really against Islam.
I mean.
But alhamdulillah, I've heard that he's interested in Islam. I know he looks up to me as a role model. He's always, you know, looked up to me. So inshallah, may Allah guide him. But as far as I know, none of my family members have accepted Islam. You know, subhanAllah. But they're not Christian as well. My family are not Christian. You know, now in England, most of the Christians, it's mostly the older generation. You know, most of the younger generation have left Christianity, mostly atheist now in England.
So it means you've been a Muslim for almost 8 years.
8 years, yeah.
Okay. So... do you think you have reached your destination of achieving inner peace?
Yeah, alhamdulillah. Subhanallah.
You don't have any regret about accepting Islam?
Not at all. Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. You know, Islam is the truth. You know, it is the end goal. You know, this is, you know, you have all your answers in Islam. And it's not easy. You know, you, as I said, you will lose family members. You will have difficulties. Learning the salah is not easy. Getting your salah on time is, I would say, for me, was the most difficult in the beginning. You know, learning the Fatiha, learning the salah. In the beginning, this is all foreign. You know, you're not used to this type of thing.
So can you please give an advice? Because some of our brothers and sisters here are still new in Islam.
Yeah,
can you
mashallah.
Please give them some advice in order how to memorize Fatiha, the first chapter of the Quran, so that in order for them to establish the prayer, because prayer is the first thing that will be asked on the slave, the day of judgment, from among his deeds. So some of our brothers and sisters here are just new to Islam, a week or a month, and some of them find difficulty. Can you please give them some advice how to do it?
I mean, you know, it requires effort. You know, don't think that, you know, that it's just going to come to you. You need to put time into your religion. You need to, you know, take out time of your life to study Islam, learn Islam. It's not just going to come straight away. But the main thing with the Fatiha is, you know, if you can't read Arabic, you can read a kind of transliteration in your own language, you know, just how to pronounce the words, specifically for Fatiha, because it's so important that you know the Fatiha. Because this is the real, one of the, you know, the pillars of the Salah.
Even me, when I became Muslim, it took me 3 days to memorize the prayer.
Mashallah.
I prayed my own, because I accepted Islam in the country as well, in the Philippines.
Mashallah.
But sorry to say that the way I pronounce Surah Al-Fatiha is completely wrong.
In the beginning?
In the beginning. I used to say, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. But when I was able to study Islam in one of the institute in our country, alhamdulillah, I was able to pronounce Fatiha in a proper way.
Yes.
Because even one of the scholars of Islam said that reciting Fatiha in a wrong way will make your prayer invalidated.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's one of the pillars of prayer. So also I advise my, the brothers and the sisters, to learn Islam, you have to put in your hearts the fear of Allah. Because Allah's promise in the Quran when he said, Fattaqullaha wa yu'allimukum Allah. Fear Allah and Allah will teach you. This is the first thing.
Subhanallah. And it's to know the importance of the salah. You know, subhanallah, this really is the key to Islam. You know, this is the first thing that you'll be questioned about on Yawm al-Qiyamah. It's the second pillar of Islam. It's the first action that you're told to do. You know, since I accepted Islam, as I said, I studied locally, you know. Alhamdulillah, in Manchester, we don't have a lot of Islamic institutions. We don't have many scholars in England, really. And it's quite difficult, you know. And subhanAllah, when you first come to Islam, a lot of people learn Islam from YouTube. And this can be a good thing, but it can also be a bad thing. Because if you're new to Islam, you don't know which are the correct sources of Islam. You know, so you really have to know where you're taking your knowledge from. This is also a very important point. You know, you find with a lot of new Muslims in the West, you know, subhanAllah, they've been through every single group of Islam you can imagine, you know, because they're just being, you know, guided by the tide. You know, so it's so important that you go, you know, you find some knowledgeable brothers or sisters to help you and show you the way to access Islam.
Because as a new Muslim, you tend to follow whatever you find in the other Muslims.
Yeah.
I remember when I was a new Muslim, people beside me, they're wiping their face, and I also did it. I remember when the center was still in Karama, there was one brother from India who accepted Islam. It was a dhuhr prayer. So I said, we will go to the masjid to pray. When we reached the masjid, it was over. So I taught him how to make wudu. And we went inside the masjid. And one brother came and he said, you lead the prayer. And I said, no, you have to lead the prayer. And I will assist this brother because he was a new Muslim. I said, no, you lead. So I said to the brother, just follow what he's doing. So whatever action this brother is doing, the new Muslim is following it. So in Hiwab, my advice to the new Muslim is to learn from the proper sources.
Yes.
It's so important. You cannot just learn Islam from the YouTube and the books.
And subhanAllah, you have to understand that you have to always be in a state of seeking knowledge.
Yeah.
Don't think that you have the answer and that your answer will never change. SubhanAllah, because maybe someone can bring evidence and to change something that you're actually doing. You know, and always stay sincere. You know, be open-minded and understand that, you know, you practice your religion according to the evidence.
Yeah.
You know, this is so important. You know, recently, yesterday I came from Africa, in West Africa. And, you know, SubhanAllah, in certain countries, you know, they've had so much calamity like war and disease. And so they're really lacking in certain Islamic practices, in some masajid, not all. And but they're very sincere. They want to learn.
Yeah.
You know, I noticed in one of the mosques, they were doing things that is not correct.
Yeah.
But subhanAllah, when I explained to them, they immediately stopped it. And they said, brother, we need you to come and teach us. You need you to send teachers, you know. And subhanAllah, this is the main thing. As long as you stay sincere and you want to, you know, practice Islam according to the correct way, you know, subhanAllah, you know, Allah will guide you, subhanAllah. You have to really stay sincere. You know, I'm just coming back from a very busy trip.
Yeah.
I just returned from Africa. I went from Kuwait to Ethiopia.
Okay.
And I actually missed my flight, my connecting flight from Ethiopia. And I was actually stuck in Ethiopia for 3 days. But alhamdulillah, I managed to go and see the surrounding area of King Najashi, which was actually the first place of Hijrah.
Yeah, first.
You know, where the Muslims, subhanAllah, in their own homes, the first Muslims, you know, subhanAllah, you know, they left their families, they left their house for the sake of Allah, and they went and did Hijrah, subhanAllah. And it was a great experience to see this. And then I went to Dakar, Senegal.
Yeah.
And then from there I went to Morocco. And from Morocco I went to Mali.
Yeah.
SubhanAllah. And then from Mali I went to Sierra Leone. And in Sierra Leone, I actually went back to Sierra Leone about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
And I started to do charity work. I started to refurbish schools, Islamic schools, and support the education. You know, and this is a very important thing, you know, especially for these poorer countries, you know, to support the education.
So you love to travel.
Yeah, alhamdulillah.
So you're a journeyman.
Well, I used to travel a lot before Islam, but now, you know, alhamdulillah, if it's something to do with Islam, I like to travel, alhamdulillah.
Because this life, this worldly life is just, we're on a journey.
SubhanAllah.
We're a stranger. We're a traveler here.
Yes.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Abdullah bin Umar radhiyallahu anhuma, he said, "Kun fi dunya ka annaka gharib aw abir as-sabil." Be in this world as if you're a stranger or a traveler.
Yes.
So inshallah, may Allah will guide us to reach our destination.
Amen.
Which is Darus Salam.
Amen.
The place of peace, which is Jannah, one of the names of paradise, Darus Salam. Inshallah, I will share some of my things in order to achieve this peace, in order to reach salam. So brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Why nobody answered me except the sister? What did I do? I greeted you in the beginning, right? What did I do the second time when I said assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh? What did I do? No, what did I do? My question, what did I do to you? Is it only a simple greeting? It's not a simple greeting. A salam is not a simple greeting. It has a meaning behind it. Why I have to keep on repeating, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is not a greeting. This is a supplication. This is a dua for you that may the peace and blessings and mercy of Allah be upon you. Amen. It's not only I can greet you with good morning, good evening, good day, good night. How are you? I can greet you with that. But I am supplicating to Allah for you that may the peace, blessings, and mercy of Allah be upon you. Why? Because I love you for the sake of Allah. Because in order to enter paradise, we have to spread salam. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tu'minu, la tadkhulu al-jannata hatta tu'minu." No one from among you will enter paradise until you believe. "Wala tu'minu hatta tahabu." And you will not be a believer until you love each other. "Ala adullukum bi shay'in idha fa'altumuhu tahabbtum?" Shall I inform you a thing that if you will do it, you will learn to love each other? They said, "Certainly, Ya Rasulullah." Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Afshu salama bainakum." Spread the greetings of salam between you. So, my greetings of assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, it gives you inner peace. I'm praying to Allah that may Allah will accept us in Jannah. What is Jannah? Darus Salam. Wallahu yad'u ila Daris Salam. Allah is calling to Daris Salam, the place of peace, the place of security, the place of tranquility. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ya ayyuhan nas, afshu salam wa at'imu ta'am wa sallu bil-layli wa nasu niyam, tadkhulul jannata bis-salam." O people, spread the greetings of salam, feed the hungry, and pray at night while the people are asleep, and you will enter paradise in peace. So who wants paradise? Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
We have to spread salam, because this is the greetings of the angels when we reach the door of paradise. وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ تَقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُوهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا وَقَالَ لَهُمْ خَزَنَتُهَا سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ طِبْتُمْ فَادْخُلُوهَا خَالِدِينَ. When those who used to fear their Lord will be brought upon the door of paradise, the angels who are guarding paradise will greet them. Salamun alaikum, you have done well. So don't be bakhil in this word salam, because this is one of the names of Allah. Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam. And the greetings of people of paradise will be salam. Wa udkhila al-jannatu wa udkhila alladhina amanu. And those who believe will enter paradise. وَعَمِلُوا صَالِحَاتِ, and those who does righteous deeds. وَأُدْخِلَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا صَالِحَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا تَحِيَّتُهُمْ فِيهَا سَلَامٌ. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ تَحِيَّتُهُمْ فِيهَا سَلَامٌ. They will enter paradise by the permission of your Lord, and their greetings will be salam. So spread the greetings of salam in order to achieve salam. Salam has so many meaning. It can mean peace, it can mean security, it can mean prosperity, it can mean tranquility. So salam and Islam and iman or aman is related. So inner peace cannot be achieved by abundance of wealth. You can't. Inner peace is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man asbaha minkum aminan fi sirbi mu'afan fi jasadi wa indahu quwwatu yawmi ka'annahu hizat lahu dunya." Whoever among you wakes up in the morning secure in his environment, healthy in his body, and he have something to eat for the day, it is as if he owns the whole world. Subhanallah, you don't have money. There's no money involved. What is the use of money when you're not secure? When you go out of your house, you will be mugged, you'll be robbed, you'll be killed. What is the use of money when you are sick? You cannot eat the food that you want.
You know, subhanAllah, Shaykh, you know, I was in Manchester last year, and I was with some friends of mine from Saudi. They were Saudi students, and we were on the public. About salam, how to greet, you know, now in England, subhanAllah.
Morning, maybe the peace.
SubhanAllah.
Have peace in inner and outside. But if we have salam, alhamdulillah. So I will tell them what are those steps in order to achieve salam inwardly and outwardly. First is by accepting Islam. By accepting Islam itself, that's what you did, you will achieve peace. Your fear, sorrow will be removed. As Allah promised in the Quran, and Allah will never ever break his promise. Inna Allah la yukhlifu al-bi'ad. He said, Bala man aslama wajhahu lillahi wa huwa muhsin fala khawfun alayhi. See? Wala hum yahzanun. Bala man aslama wajhahu, whoever submits, whoever is sincere, Bala man aslama wajhahu lillahi, to Allah, wa huwa muhsin, and he's a good doer. Falahu ajruhu inda rabbi, his reward is with his Lord. Fala khawfun alayhim wa lahum yahzanun, for them they shall not grieve nor worry. So Islam will make us to achieve peace. And what else? We will mention the five pillars of Islam. The five pillars of Islam will help us to achieve peace. First, the shahada time. When we say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given in the Quran a similitude. He said, Daraballahu mathalan rajulan fihi shuraka mutashakisuna wa rajulan salama li rajul. Hal yastawiyani mathalan. Allah has given a similitude of a man who belong to many masters. He has so many boss. He has so many masters to obey. And the other one who is only committed to one boss. Which one is safe and which one is confused? The one who has many bosses. Allah ta'ala confi. It is only by following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is the meaning of ashhadu an la ilaha illallah by saying Rabbunallah. Thumma istaqamu by following the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. This is a promise of Allah. So the first pillar of Islam is shahada time. And if you disobey Allah, and if you disobey his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah has sworn in the Quran, subhanallah, he said, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ عَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةٌ أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Let them be warned, those who oppose the command of the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, we are not allowed to disobey the command of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah. The second pillar of Islam, how will we give us peace? As-salah, the prayer. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa for the first time, Allah said in the Quran, Innani an Allah. Musa, verily I am Allah. La ilaha illa ana. So it's also connected to La ilaha to the first pillar, shahada time. Fa'budni, so worship me. Wa aqimi salata li dhikri. And establish prayer for my remembrance. So the prayer, the other name of prayer is a dhikr. So if you remember Allah, you are satisfied. You are at peace. When Allah in the Quran, the ayah that you have quoted in English when we start our conversation, Allah in the Quran, this is in Surah Al-Ra'd. Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. Only in the remembrance of Allah, the hearts find peace. The hearts find satisfaction. Even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to say to Bilal, arihna biha ya Bilal. Comfort us, Bilal. comfort us. This is as-salah, the first thing to be asked on the day of judgment. So as new Muslims here, we advise you, do not abandon prayer. Do not cut your relationship with Allah. And you will be at peace. And also, the zakah, the third pillar of Islam, az-zakah. How will it give us tranquility or peace or security? Allah said in the Quran, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. Take from their wealth, okay, a charity that will purify their wealth. Because sometimes a person, without knowing, he may earn some haram money. So in order to purify it, he has to give zakah on it. وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. So that they will be purified inwardly. Why? It keeps us from being greedy, from being selfish. And those who are poor will be free from jealousy. And their heart is free from jealousy because they are receiving the zakat. And take note the following words. When Allah commanded Prophet Muhammad خُدْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. Allah said to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wasallu alayhim. Pray for them, supplicate for them, invoke for them. Inna salataka sakanun lahum. Because your invocation, your dua for those who pay the zakah is a source of security for them. Imagine, brother. We were commanded by Allah in the Quran that this is being recited by the Khatib during Jum'ah. When Allah said in the Quran, Inna Allah wa malaikata yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayuhaladhina amanu, sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Verily Allah and His angels, you know, pray to for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay? So, oh you who believe, pray for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But, in zakah, Allah commanded Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to pray for those who pay the zakah. Wasallu alayhim. Why your prayer for them, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is a source of security. Security in where? In punishment. When on the day of judgment, yawma yuhma fi nari jahannama. When that day, when their wealth will be heated in fire. وَتُقْوَى بِهَا جُنُوبُهَا جُنُوبُهُمْ جِبَابُهُمْ وَظُهُورُهُمْ هَذَا مَا كَنَزْتُمْ لِأَنفُسِكُمْ. Your wealth will be heated and will be branded in their forehead, in their sides, in their back. And it will be said to them, taste the punishment of you, what you have hoarded from your wealth. So giving zakah is a source of security from the punishment. Safety, peace, and also fasting. Fasting,
subhanAllah,
is a source of salam. Why? What was the purpose of fasting? Allah said in the Quran, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, okay, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, fasting has been prescribed upon you, as it can be prescribed to those who came before you.
Yes.
So that you become pious. You become righteous. Okay? So, you know, the result of piety? If a person is righteous, he will achieve salam. Why? Allah said in the Quran, وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. And paradise will be brought near, not far. وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةِ الْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. هَذَا مَا تُوعَدُونَ لِكُلِّ أَوَابٍ حَفِيدٍ. This is what you have been promised. مَنْ خَشَّ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who fear the most gracious in secret. Why? Fasting is only between you and Allah. A person can say the shahada in front of people, but not from his heart. Maybe a person can pray to show to people that he's praying, but not from his heart. A person can pay the zakah in front of people to look, he's generous. But fasting is only between him and Allah.
Only Allah knows.
Only Allah knows. So man khashya rahmana bil ghaib wa ja'a bi qalbi munib. Udkhuluha bis salam. Udkhuluha bis salam. Enter in peace. Where? In paradise. So a result of fasting will give you peace.
And specifically the month of Ramadan.
Month of Ramadan.
No one will doubt the peace in Ramadan. Subhanallah.
Peace and happiness. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that all the deeds of the sons of Adam is for him, except fasting. It is only for me, and I will be the one to give reward. Wa ana adzibeh. So he continued by saying, lisa'imi farhatan. For the fasting person, he has two happiness, he has two joys. The day, the time when he breaks his fast. Farhatan in the fitrihi, wa farhatan in the liqa'i rabbih. The joy when he will meet his Lord, where? In paradise. In paradise, Allah will reveal his noble face. Udkhuluha bisalam, dhalika yawmul khulud, lahum ma yasha'una fiha, wa ladayna mazid. What's al-mazid? What is more? Is that when Allah will reveal his noble face to the Ahlil Jannah. May Allah will count us from among the Ahlil Jannah.
Amen.
The another thing that will help us achieve security, inshallah, is the Hajj. Hajj. Performing Hajj. Allah said in the Quran, Inna awala baytin wudi'a linnasi lalladhi bibakkata mubaraka huda lil alamin. Verily, the first house of worship appointed for mankind is in Bakka, in Makkah, Mukarrama. Huda lil alamin, a guidance for the alamin. Fihi ayat bayinat maqam Ibrahim. In it, there is a clear sign, especially the station of Abraham. Wa man dakhalaha kana amina. Whoever enters this place, he is secured. He is at peace. For those brothers and sisters who've been to Umrah, sponsored by our center, alhamdulillah, they told me when they came back, brothers, when we saw the Kaaba, we forgot everything of this dunya. Security, peace, inner peace. And another thing that will help us after Hajj, what we have to do? Allah said in the Quran, that after performing your manasik of Hajj, فَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ كَذِكْرِكُ أَبَاكُمْ. Remember Allah as you remember your father. So the next is to remember Allah. أَلَا بِذِكْرَ لِتَطْمَئِنُ الْقُلُوبِ. So inshallah, because I need to speak more, but the time is very short. Inshallah, may the story of brother John Fontaine will serve as an inspiration for you, inshallah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide many people in Islam through the story of brother John Fontaine, inshallah. So I leave you with the greetings of salam. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Are we going to have questions?
If you have some questions, brothers and sisters, feel free, inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum
salam. Brother, we will thank you for this inspiring literature, this talk, and for your visit. I would like to ask that I know that you already were writing a few books about Islam, or just if you can give us some information about the books that you already have maybe printed, or it's available or not, or you're working on some other literature about Islam from your experience and
I've written some dawah booklets, some small pamphlets which are used for dawah, mainly, you know, like the five pillars, six articles of faith, like the Sheikh was explaining. This is to benefit non-Muslims. Also, I have a small pamphlet on about Christianity, you know, the Islamic perspective of the previous books which were revealed from Allah to the messengers. I'm also writing, well, I've nearly finished a book on atheism. It's called The God Solution. The full title is Islam, the Missing Link, The God Solution. And this is about atheism, because atheism is something that is growing not only in Europe, but all over the world. And so I've written this book answering some of the misconceptions that many people have, including Muslims, about atheism. This one, inshallah, will be published. I'll be publishing this soon, inshallah. And I'm also working on a big book for Jesus and the Injil, which is also a more in-depth book about the Islamic perspective of Wahi and the previous revelations. And it's also outlining the Islamic perspective of the previous books, because often this is a big misconception amongst Muslims, because many Muslims think that we believe in the Bible, but the Bible is something different. The Bible is a collection of different biographies about the prophets. You know, it's like a collection of seerah, as opposed to being a wahi from Allah. So I'm just outlining the Islamic position on the Bible and the separate point about the Islamic perspective of the revelation, the wahi that Allah sent to the messengers. And these are two totally different things, which are often thought or misrepresented to be the same thing. So this is the main book that I'm working on, and one about atheism. But as I said, I have some small dawah booklets as well, which are currently being printed in the UK and other places as well, like Malaysia and Saudi and different places.
So are these books available online? Or?
At the moment, they're not available. They've finished.
So you haven't published it yet?
Yeah, they've been published, the dawah booklets. But the booklets are printed for free. So we distribute them for free. They're currently printed in Birmingham and Malaysia, Kuwait and Saudi. Yeah. And they're printing them. But the actual books which I'm working on, the two big books, I've not published them yet. No.
Yeah, it will serve as a sadaqatan jariyah for you, continuous charity. Inshallah. Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that إذا مات ابن آدم قد عمل إلا من ثلاث. When the son of Adam dies, all his deeds will come to an end except three: a righteous son, and a beneficial knowledge, you know, and a continuous charity. So this knowledge that you have left, inshallah, will be leaving behind, inshallah, will benefit us on the grave.
Inshallah.
I was wondering before the meaning of in the grave, because we know as Muslims, we know there is a life in the grave, barzakh. Okay, and normally, when you go to some non-Muslim cemeteries, they will write R.I.P.
Rest in peace.
Rest in peace. Okay. Rest in peace. But for me, I have a different meaning with that. R.I.P., if you are disobedient to Allah, it means receive the initial punishment. Because we will be there will be punishment in grave.
Yeah.
And for Muslims, receive the initial pleasure.
Inshallah. Subhanallah.
So, when you publish this book and people will benefit from that, inshallah, it will serve as,
inshallah,
as your comfort,
inshallah,
in your grave, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Inshallah. Because we want comfort, we want tranquility.
Inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Good question.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I have a short question for clarification. As you say, just in a moment ago, the zakah is a third pillar of Islam. If the person is a Muslim and that person is earning his money or his wealth in a bad way, which is mean is haram. If he pay, I mean, if he or she pay the zakah, did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept that worship or sacrifice of them? Thank you. Jazakallahu khairan.
We have to remember the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he said, "Inna Allah tayyib la yaqbalu illa tayyiba." Allah is pure and he accepts only what is pure. Get the point? So you know that. You can use this from the harams, or you can use this for general benefit, within shades or roads or whatever. But
subhanAllah. Yeah. You know, the answers of the Prophet are very short and to the point, mashallah. Yeah.
Very short answer. Inna Allah tayyib la yaqbal illa tayyiba.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi.
Brother John talked about the family when he told his family that he's converting. So I converted in my first year when I'm here, that was 2015. And after 6 months, I converted after seeing the uniqueness of the religion, the people.
Mashallah.
So I decided to convert.
Love it.
But it took me a long time, around 6 months, to tell my mom that I've really converted. So my question is, how can you help the new Muslims to get prepared to tell their family about the converting, like they have converted to the new Muslim, to the new religion, because some families are not ready for that.
Yes.
So, some new Muslims who are converting, maybe they're scared.
Yes.
They're scared to tell their people how they will react because we come from different backgrounds.
Inshallah.
And
where are you from, brother?
I'm from Uganda.
Mashallah.
Because I decided that in my first Ramadan, I'll tell my mom that I've converted.
Yes.
At first, she was not happy about it, but I really tried and convinced her. And now, I think she's okay.
Yes.
And by the time I go home, I'll try to tell her more about the religion, because it's really, really a nice religion.
Yes.
It's a religion of peace.
MashaAllah. JazakAllah khair. SubhanAllah, you know, I always advise new Muslims, especially living in non-Muslim countries, to not tell your parents straight away. Mm. I advise this personally. SubhanAllah, in my local masjid in Manchester, there's somebody who works there, and his job is to find accommodation for new Muslims who have been thrown out of their house. Mm-hmm. SubhanAllah. You know, it's an actual job at the masjid, just to find accommodation. Because it's such, you know, it's such a common thing, because understandably, non-Muslims have a lot of misconceptions about Islam, and they don't know anything about Islam. They're not taught anything about Islam. And all they know is what they see in the media. So understandably, they're very worried out of love for you. They're not doing it because they hate you. You know, they're just genuinely worried about you. So you have to understand this. And if you've just accepted Islam, most likely you don't know much about Islam. Maybe you've not learned the Salah yet. Maybe you've not understood Tawheed properly. You know, there's still a lot of issues. There's still a lot of things that you need to learn. And as soon as you tell your parents or your family, you are going to be questioned. You're going to be grilled. You know, they're going to be asking you so many questions, and you might not know the answer. So I always recommend take some time off. 6 months, like the brother did. 1 year, even 2 years. I didn't tell my family for 2 years.
Really?
2 years. I didn't tell them I was a Muslim. And when I told them I was a Muslim, I thought they would be happy for me. But subhanAllah, they wasn't. And this is the reality throughout the whole world. You see this. Even in Muslim families and Muslim households, you'll find a brother who started practicing recently, or a sister, maybe she just started to wear hijab, or a brother, he started to grow the beard. And the same thing also happens in the Muslim homes, where you know, parents who don't have much knowledge about Islam, they become worried. They think that, you know, you're becoming extreme or something. So you have to understand that people lack knowledge of Islam, so don't rush to tell your family. You know, wait until it's the right time. Wait till you have more knowledge about Islam and slowly tell them about Islam. And don't push it. Don't think your parents are going to accept Islam, you know, overnight. You know, maybe they'll accept Islam. I know brothers who their parents have accepted Islam. I know brothers like myself whose family have not accepted Islam. Just take it very slowly. It wouldn't have took you one day to accept Islam. It took you some time. So understand, you know, don't try to, you know, change them overnight. It takes some time. And don't think that you're pressured to tell your family straight away. You know, for the non-Muslims, don't feel any pressure to have to tell anyone. Just tell your close friends and learn the religion. Start your journey to peace.
To add to that, to the question of the brother, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. O you who believe, save yourselves and your families from fire. So you have to concentrate first on yourself.
Yes.
Okay? And later on, if you have enough knowledge, share it with your family.
Yes.
Who are your family? Your mother, your father, if you have a wife or children. But your first family is your mother and your father. So how you will deal with them? Ud'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah. Call unto the way of your Lord with wisdom. وَالْمَوْعِدَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِلَتِهِ أَحْسَنَ. Beautiful preaching. And argue with them in a nice way. This is the guidance of Allah. So with regards to our parents, subhanAllah, a man came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked him, Ya Rasulullah, أَيُّ النَّاسِ بِحُسْنِ صَحَابَتِي. Among people, who was the one who was the more right of my good companionship? So Prophet Muhammad mentioned mother three times. And the father is one time. So your first family is your mother, your father. So listen to the words of Allah, brother, the questioner. Allah said in the Quran, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. And we have enjoined on man to be good to his parents. حَمَّلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَحْنًا عَلَى وَحْنٍ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَمَيْنِ. His mother bore him witness upon hardship and witness upon hardship, and his weaning is 2 years. And اشْكُرْ لِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَ الْمَصِيرِ. Give thanks to me and to your parents, and to me is your final return. وَإِنْ جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَنْ تُشْرِكَ بِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. But if they strive against you, command you to worship others besides me, then follow them not.
Yeah.
But behave with them, live with them in this world with kindness. Be kind to your parents, even if they're non-Muslims. Asma bint Abu Bakr radiallahu anha came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because her mother is asking something from her. So because she's not a Muslim, Asma bint Abu Bakr radiallahu anha is hesitant to give her what she needs before asking Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when she asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what was the reply of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Be good to your mother. So, how to show your goodness to your mother, your parents, is to take them away from misguidance to guidance, from the darkness of shirk to the light of tawheed, from the filth of kufr to the purity of iman. May Allah will guide your family and our family to Islam. Alhamdulillah.
Any more questions?
So I think we need to
think this one more.
I think somebody wants to accept Islam. Fi kam am Abdullah? Thalatha?
Mashallah.
Inshallah. Jazakumullah. When bisharun hin and al masrah wala?
Mashallah.
Wala hinak and al jumhur.
Is there anyone else who would like to accept Islam?
Yeah. You know, one thing I would like to add. This is about personal things. How to achieve inner peace? It is to have a righteous family. A righteous family. Why? Because if your wife or your husband or your children are not following Islam, how can you have inner peace?
SubhanAllah.
Thinking that you'll be asked by Allah on the Day of Judgment about them. As Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun an ra'yati." Every one of you is responsible, and every one of you will be asked about that responsibility. How can you achieve inner peace? You may appear in front of people, you are happy, you are contented, you are, but if there is no harmony inside the house itself, that is why we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this dua. Inshallah, you'll memorize this. This dua is in the Quran. Allah said in the Quran, Rabbana hablana min azwajina wa dhurriyatina qurrata ayun wa ja'alna lil muttaqina imama. Our Lord, bestow upon us a righteous wives and children, that they will be the comfort of our eyes.
Amen.
Happiness of our eyes.
Amen.
And make us a leader Amen. Of the pious.
Amen.
Subhanallah.
Mashallah.
Because our family sometimes. When they share on Hina?
Mashallah. There's three sisters who like to accept Islam.
We have three sisters from Uganda.
Mashallah. He will do it, inshallah. Okay. Sisters, you just repeat after John Fontaine's testimony. It will be in Arabic.
Assalamu alaikum, sisters.
Alaikum salam.
Alaikum salam.
Alaikum salam.
MashaAllah. Where are you from?
Uganda.
MashaAllah. You know, subhanAllah, I've been to Uganda. There's so many people coming to Islam, mashallah. You know, we're very happy that you've come today and that you've looked into Islam.
Mashallah.
Are you all ready to accept Islam? Have you been doing some research before?
Yes, teacher Fatima.
Alhamdulillah.
Mashallah. And you're all ready to accept Islam?
Yes, we are ready.
Okay, first of all, We'll say it in English so that you understand what we're going to say. So it's to understand that there's nothing worthy of worship except Allah, and that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the final messenger. And that Jesus, peace be upon him, is also a messenger of Allah, and that all the prophets and messengers are messengers, and they're not a part of Allah in any way, shape, or form. Do you agree with this?
Yes.
And you've all looked into this.
Yes, sir.
Alhamdulillah. So, first of all, we'll say it in English, and you can repeat after me. You can all do it together. So it's, I bear witness that there's nothing worthy of worship.
Nothing to be worshipped.
Except Allah.
Except Allah.
And I bear witness.
And I bear witness.
That Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon you.
Is the final messenger.
Is the final messenger.
And that Jesus, peace be upon him.
And that Jesus, peace be upon him.
Is the final messenger.
Is the final messenger.
Okay, now we're going to say it in Arabic. Don't be worried, because you can repeat after me, inshallah. Are you ready?
Yes.
So it's Ashhadu.
Ashhadu.
An la.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illa Allah.
Illa Allah.
Wa ashhadu.
Wa ashhadu.
Anna.
Anna
Muhammadan
Rasulullah.
Takbir.
Allahu Akbar.
Allahu Akbar. Takbir. Takbir. MashaAllah.
Congratulations, Allahu Akbar. Sisters.
I'm very happy for you, sisters.
For accepting Islam.
MashaAllah. Allahu Akbar.
Okay, sister, she has some questions.
I would like
brother.
To give you a piece of advice after accepting Islam.
Allahu Akbar.
The advice that was given by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to one of his companions. A very beneficial advice, a very precious advice, that if all Muslims will live according to this advice, this world were a better place to live in. What is that advice? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Mu'adh bin Jabal radhiyallahu anhu, "Ya Mu'adh, ittaqillah haythuma kunt." So he advised you, the same advice of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fear Allah wherever you are. Do not fear Allah while inside the Islamic center in lectures. No, fear Allah wherever you are, in the bus, in the market, in your workplace. Fear Allah, because your Lord is ever watchful. Inna rabbaka labil mersad. Our Lord is ever watchful. The second advice is, wa'atbi is sayyat al-hasanata tamhuha. Follow up a bad deed with the good deeds that will erase it. We are humans. We are not perfect. We commit mistakes. As Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, kullu bani adam khata wa khairul khatina tawwabun. All the sons of Adam commit mistakes, commit sins, but the best of all the sinners is he who repents. So when you commit mistakes, it's normal. You're a new Muslim, inshallah, because now at the moment all your previous sins has been forgiven by Allah. You are pure. You are pure. You are the best among us here.
Allahu Akbar.
Three of you. Where some sins already. But you, three of you, you are pure. Please pray for us. And the third advice is that wa khalaqin nasa bi khuluqin hasan. Behave well towards people. Show to them that you are Muslim, that you change your religion for the better in order to call them. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, he said, call people to Islam even in silence. Without words. So he was asked how. He said, by your behavior. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave da'wah by his good behavior. He was sent by Allah to complete the most noble behavior. He said, inna ma bu'ithu li utammima makarim al akhlaq. I was sent to complete the most noble behavior. So jazakumul khair, inshallah, for accepting Islam. May Allah make your journey to Darussalam easy.
Amen.
And don't forget to call your families to Islam.
Do we have anyone else who would like to accept Islam?
I'm sorry, brother.
We would really like to help you with this, inshallah. It's a very good blessing, mashallah.
Just Sheikh, jazakumullah khair. May Allah reward you and accept to everybody. Our sister, she wants to ask some question. It's a very important question. If you give him the chance, jazakumullah.
Inshallah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh.
I can hear.
As we have accepted Islam, now our family doesn't know that we are Muslim. And Sister Fatma taught us today that we have to accept destiny, whereby destiny, it's included death also. Anytime you can die. But if you die here, they take you back to your country. Your parents, they know you as a Christian. They bury you in Christian faith. How is God going to judge you? That is my question. Assalamu alaikum.
So your question is, when you go back to your country.
She's asking something. Is Allah His knows about the when she's going to pass away? So what happened if she going to the country? If nobody knows she's Muslim and she's born, is going to the grave of the Christianity.
So be patient, sister. Be patient. Whatever harm may come on your way, in your journey to Islam, in your journey to Jannah, be patient. We have to realize that this life is full of tests, and paradise is a place of rest.
You know, the sister's asking specifically, subhanAllah, this is an amazing question for someone who's just been Muslim for 1 minute, mashallah. You know, she's already thinking about the hereafter. The first question she's asked when she's become a Muslim is she's thinking about the grave. She said, basically, that her family are Christian, and they don't know that she's become a Muslim. And if she was to pass away here in the UAE, then usually the process is that they send the body back to the home country. And of course, the family, being Christian, will bury them in a Christian way. SubhanAllah, this shows great remembrance of Allah that, you know, you're seeking to be buried as a Muslim. Allahu Akbar, this is an amazing thing. But subhanAllah, this is not something that is in your hands. You know, even a Muslim, you know, maybe a Muslim travels to China or any other country in the world and passes away, and we don't know what would happen to the body. So for you, I don't think you need to worry about this. You know, may Allah grant you, you know, a Muslim husband, and that you can have, you know, a family. And subhanAllah, you leave this in the hands of Allah. You leave it up to Allah. And may Allah grant you, you know, your wish to be buried as a Muslim with the Muslims. Ameen.
There is a brother here in Dubai who is offering his free services to the new Muslims.
MashaAllah.
He has an office that offers new Muslims the ability to write their last will and testament.
Yes, subhanAllah.
So, I have his contact number. You can visit his office to make your last will and testament, that whatever happened to you in any parts of the world, you will be buried according to Islamic tradition.
Yes, yes. This is something we have also in the UK.
Yeah.
And countries that are not exactly Muslim countries, you know, you can write a contract, yeah, a will. And
actually, this brother is from UK.
Oh, is he, mashallah?
Yeah, he used to pray in our English masjid in Jumeirah.
Okay, what's his name?
Muhammad Maria.
Okay, mashallah.
So, for the brothers who are interested and the sisters who are interested to make last will and testament, you can contact us and we'll give his number to you, inshallah.
Mashallah. It's a very good, mashallah. What a beautiful question from a new Muslim, mashallah. Already thinking about the grave, because, you know, as Muslims, we know that this life is just a temporary life, you know, and how many of us are actually planning our death? How many of us are planning, you know, our hereafter? SubhanAllah, amazing, mashallah.
Yeah. Allahu Akbar. This is a terminator of pleasure.
SubhanAllah.
It will not knock on your door.
SubhanAllah.
Yeah. Death will come upon us any time.
MashaAllah.
So, Jazakumullah khairan for coming to the lecture, inshallah.
Allahu Akbar.
May Allah will put in our hearts,
ameen,
peace, tranquility, serenity, and security. Ameen. Because this is the only thing that can help us on the Day of Judgment, not our wealth or our sons. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالُ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ صَلَّى بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On that day when your sons and your wealth cannot avail you, except the one who will face Allah with a pure heart.
Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu
alaikum.
Inshallah. Jazakallah.